All right, everybody, welcome back to our next lesson on hemodynamics. In this lesson, we are going to talk about the delivery of oxygen, which is ultimately the end goal of our hemodynamics. The goal is to deliver oxygen as well as nutrients to perfuse our end tissues, and also while they're taking away any waste products that are a result of metabolism. But ultimately, the most important thing is getting the oxygen to our tissues. And in this lesson, we're going to talk about and we're going to cover a few different equations that are used in understanding our hemodynamics. I do want to preface this and say the point of this is not to have these as something that you guys need to memorize, but really just to break it down and help you understand the components that all play a factor in the hemodynamics and ultimately the delivery of oxygen. So the first equation we're going to look at is just that, our delivery of oxygen. So this is going to be our DO2. And the equation for our DO2 consists simply of our cardiac output times the concentration of oxygen in the arteries times a factor of 10. And the 10 is really just there to get our units of cardiac output and the concentration of oxygen all on the same page. Now, you may look at this equation, it may seem a little scary or overwhelming in trying to understand how does this play into hemodynamics. And like I said, the goal is to understand the components. Our end goal is to deliver oxygen, and in this case, we can see that the components that make up our delivery of oxygen are our cardiac output, which is going to be how much blood we're circulating through our body, and their concentration of arterial oxygen, which is basically how concentrated is the oxygen in the blood that we're beating. So the concept is pretty simple, but I do want to break this down a little bit further in order to better understand what is happening. So the first one I want to talk about is our concentration of arterial oxygen. So that's going to be our CaO2. And big surprise, guess what? There is an equation that we can use to determine what this concentration is. And this is going to consist of our hemoglobin times 1.39 times our arterial oxygen saturation. Then we're going to add our partial pressure of arterial oxygen and multiply that by 0.003. Now you're probably looking back at the DO2 equation, and initially we were thinking that that was kind of a complicated equation to look at, and now you're looking at this and you're like, what the heck is going on here? So again, my point of this isn't, I don't want you to memorize this equation. There may come a point later on in your nursing career as you become more advanced, more trained, that this may play a role in some of your practice. But for the most part, the reason I'm explaining this here is I want you to understand a couple key concepts that I want to take away from this. The first of these is that in order to determine how concentrated our oxygen is in our blood, that there's three factors that go into this. We have our hemoglobin, we have our oxygen saturation, and we have the partial pressure of oxygen, which is going to be our PaO2 off of our ABG. And if you take a look and see where these components play into this equation, you can see that our PaO2 actually makes up a pretty insignificant portion of our concentration of oxygen, because we're going to multiply that by 0.003. Whereas our hemoglobin and our oxygen saturation, we're multiplying by 1.39, so obviously we're going to end up with a larger number. So to really drive this point home, I do want to give you some values so we can plug it into the equation here and really see the point that I'm trying to make. So let's say we have a hemoglobin of 7. We would take that and multiply that by 1.39. Then we would multiply by, let's say we have an oxygen saturation of 0.95. If we do the math on this, this gives us a grand total of roughly 9.24. Now, if we move over to the other side of the equation, Let's say we have a partial pressure of oxygen off our ABG that is 400. We'll multiply that by 0.003, and that'll give us 1.2. So here you can see, even with a very high partial pressure of oxygen, it's still only composing a tiny part of our total amount of concentrated oxygen in our blood. And really, the important takeaway from this is the two biggest factors in determining how much oxygen we're going to have in our blood is going to be our hemoglobin and our oxygen saturation. Well, hopefully that makes a little bit of sense for you guys in understanding how we determine how much oxygen is going to be in our blood. If we go back and look at our delivery of oxygen equation, the other factor that is used in determining how much oxygen we're delivering is going to be our cardiac output. And so our cardiac output, if we go ahead and bring that down here, we do have another equation for this. And this is going to be cardiac output is equal to our heart rate times our stroke volume. And if we take a look at these components, essentially what this is saying is if we take how much blood is being ejected with each beat, which is our stroke volume, and multiply that by how many beats per minute, which is our heart rate, it's going to tell us what our cardiac output is in liters per minute. So just to give you some normals on some of these numbers, our stroke volume is normally going to be 60 to 120 milliliters per beat. We should know our heart rate is normally 60 to 100 beats per minute. And our cardiac output is going to be 4 to 8 liters per minute. It is important to note that cardiac output doesn't take into consideration the size of your patient. So if you have a small lady with 4 liters of output, that's going to be a big difference when we're comparing that to 4 liters of output in, let's say, a 350-pound man. So this is where there's another thing that comes into play that we call cardiac index. And essentially, cardiac index is just going to take your cardiac output and your body surface area and determine how that output relates to the size of the person. And this way, no matter what the size the person is, we can talk about the same numbers and have an idea of how sufficient or insufficient that cardiac output is going to be for that patient. So for our cardiac index, our normal numbers are going to be 2.5 to 4. And this is actually in liters per minute per meter squared. Now finally, from all this, we can break things down one more time. And that's if we take a look at our stroke volume. There are three factors that go into determining what our stroke volume is going to be. And that is going to be our preload, our contractility, and our afterload. Now, in a little bit, we will get to talking about these different components and what they mean and how they impact our stroke volume and ultimately our cardiac output. But for now, I just want you to understand how if we take a look with our hemodynamics, our ultimate goal is about delivering oxygen. And if we take that calculation and break it down, we can see how our cardiac output is composed, as well as how the concentration of oxygen in that blood is composed. And to give you a good understanding of those components, why they're important, and ultimately how they affect our hemodynamics. And that's going to conclude this lesson on hemodynamics, talking about the delivery of oxygen. In our next lesson, we are going to talk about our cardiac output and all the different factors that play a role in determining what that cardiac output is.